At this for Captain, if you guys don't mind.
This is much better.
You live over there?
Yeah, the seventh house there on the right.
Second house there?
Seven.
Seven, yeah, I live in Woodside Circle.
Oh, you do, don't you? You were walking up the street behind me.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, we're neighbors.
Yes. Delane, and you're in the circle.
You're, that's right.
The niece and all of them.
I try to walk, I'm trying to get back in the walking, so I go right by your house.
Yeah, you do.
Or ride our bikes.
I have all the cars.
All the cars.
Well, my name is Coach Baker, and I've done sessions with these two ladies before. What is your name?
My name is Sherilyn Willis.
Okay, and what's your name?
Shirley Weeks.
Shirley.
Kathy Furster.
Okay, all right. Now, Kathleen said we were talking about different people that do mindfulness, and I'm sort of stuck on George Mumford. Now, George Mumford was the mindfulness coach for the Los Angeles Lakers and the Chicago Bulls when they were winning all those championships. And they thought it was Phil Jackson who was doing the mindfulness, but actually the Zen master was George Mumford. And just to tell you his story, he graduated and went to the University of Massachusetts and to play basketball. And his roommate was actually Dr. J, Julius Erving. And so when he got to the university, he had a knee injury. So he blew his knee out, and that really frustrated him. He still ended up finishing school, but it was a lot of mental anguish. He started turning to drugs and alcohol. He had to go to rehab centers, and he just couldn't get it together. So Jon Kabat-Zinn, and Jon Kabat-Zinn is the mindfulness person who sort of has brought mindfulness up to date with the definition of mindfulness being in the present moment, paying attention in the present moment without judgment, okay? So he went to a mindfulness-based reduction center, and he started using mindfulness. So that sort of really brought him around. From there, he took off, and he wanted to kind of help other people, and that became his practice. And then, of course, he moved on to the Lakers and to the Chicago Bulls, and kind of became famous with them. And he does a lot of meditation now with college athletes. So I read his book all the time. I don't like to read, but I have audio books now. So
that's right.
So I can stay up all night with my headphones on and listen to audio books, you know. But with me being in the schools, I just use a lot of his advice, okay, a lot of his techniques when I'm teaching the kids at school. I have two schools, Churchill Academy and Douglas Park Elementary, where I'm doing mindfulness. And what I have recently found, we have a program called Inner Explore. And this is a program that the teachers, they supposed to use each day. Now, I retired from Churchill Academy last July, so I had done mindfulness a year and a half before I retired at that school. It took a while for the teachers to to get acclimated to it, but now the principle is mandatory that they do mindfulness. So it's different at Douglas Park. I've been over there for a year, going on a year and a half, and it steadily, but it was just like at church learning. It took a while for the teachers to get acclimated, and it's the same at Douglas Park. But I noticed that at the schools, the kids with the highest referrals, the teachers are not doing mindfulness. Mm-hmm. Okay, mm-hmm. The ones with the highest referrals,
yep.
The teachers are not doing mindfulness. Let me put it another way. They're doing it, but not as much as the teachers with the kids that, you know, don't have a high amount of referrals. So I'm a strong believer that that mindfulness can help change this violence that we have in our city. Okay, I can't use that phone right now. But if you would Google the most dangerous city in Virginia, Portsmouth.
Right here.
And it eats me up because, you know, I'm born and raised in Portsmouth. You know, I tell everyone, you're not gonna find too many people that went through kindergarten. Well, I got kicked out of kindergarten. I went through first grade through high school without missing a day. First grade through high school without missing a day. And since I retired, it's like I've been in the schools almost every day. And I guess it's just ingrained in me to, you know, but right now I just see a purpose. And I usually take Fridays off, and I'm usually in the schools from 9 to 12. And my wife is like, I thought you was going to be home at 12. While you going in on Fridays, you know. So, but it's, I really feel like my purpose is to develop a calmer atmosphere in the school, a calmer environment, and teaching these kids how to control their anger and how to develop compassion. Then that some of them, I'm not gonna get it at home, okay? And I just feel like school is the best place to try to implement this because they're there, they're coming to school. So while you have them, you know, we need to teach them. It's such a different kid, these days. So I just believe that you have to teach them from the inside out. You have to give them a tool that they can say, okay, if they have to understand that it's a consequence when something happens. So I always give the example of a kid walking down the hall, and the teacher says, young man, pull your pants up. I'm not pulling my pants up. You know how I teach you, blah, blah, blah. Next thing you know, he's got sent to the office, and he's expelled from or suspended from school. But you take a young man who maybe has practiced mindfulness, and you say, hey, young man, pull your pants up. But then they take a deep breath, and in that deep breath is some space for them to think and make a good decision, and they might turn around after that breath and say, yes, ma'am, I'll pull my pants up. And he'll pull his pants up, and then he'll go around the corner and pull his pants back down. But he showed that respect. He thought about what he did, and, you know, so this is what I'm trying to teach them, that when it comes to that anger moment and you have to fight somebody, don't go get a gun. You know, first thing you do is, you know, just take a deep breath and think about the consequences of what you get ready to do. So this is something that I really try to implement with the kids. these two young ladies were here when we did this activity right here. Matter of fact, this is a calming bottle, and I had a bottle for each one. And what this represents is how calm your brain should be, how calm your mind should be. You have two parts of the brain that I try to tell my staff when they go into the schools. Every kid should know, when I walk into that school, every kid should know what the amygdala is and what the prefrontal cortex. The amygdala is responsible for anger, okay? It's a little P-shape, one on this side, one on this side, straight down the middle of your brain. It's a little P-shaped tissue that controls fight, flight, fear, faint. It controls the sympathetic nervous system. A lot of thoughts. We all have negative thoughts. We all have them, okay? And they come from your amygdala. So then you have the prefrontal cortex, and that's where decision making, where you have good decision making. I always tell the kids, this is the hand model of the brain. This right here is your prefrontal cortex. And this inside right here is your amygdala. So what happens is when you get angry, or you get upset, or you get worried, all of your oxygen goes to your amygdala, okay? And you heard people say you flip your lid, or you blow your top, okay? And this is what's happening, because all of your oxygen is going right here. You're real upset, so you can't make good decisions when you're real upset. So that's why they tell you to take a deep breath, okay? And when I was telling my staff this, they was like, oh, that makes sense. So when you take a deep breath, what you do, now you're sending oxygen to your prefrontal cortex. So now you begin to calm down, okay? Because your oxygen is now going to where you can make good decisions, okay? So this is basically the same example right here. If this was the brain, it's nice and calm. But now something happens to you, and you get upset, and you have thoughts everywhere. Okay. What was that?
I love this analogy.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have it right on my counter.
You know, and if you just kind of concentrate on this, everybody just concentrate and just kind of take deep breaths. Okay. And it just calms you. I have these for the kids. We do activities. I have little teeny ones for the kindergartners and the first graders. And it teaches them how to calm themselves. Mm-hmm. So now you can see all your thoughts are dissipating. Okay. And you can get them to become calmer. Okay. All right. Now, let's talk about the breath for a minute. Let me see everybody take one deep breath. Okay. Now, I saw it here. I really didn't see it here. But when I say take one deep breath, most of you all did this. All right. So your lungs are in a pear shape. Okay, like that. So when you take that deep breath, you're taking a chest breath. So that means if that pear shape is right here and you're doing like this, all right, you're only getting half of the amount of oxygen in your lungs, okay? So what I try to tell people and tell kids to do, and you have to try to do it on your own, you have to do deep belly breathing. you have to take a deep breath. When you take a, when I see kids take a deep breath and they do like this, like Superman, they're not only, they're getting that oxygen right here compared to taking a deep belly breath. Okay, when you take a deep belly breath, your stomach is gonna come out. Just put your hands on your stomach, okay? Now, let's take a deep belly breath. This is what we're gonna do. We're gonna take a deep belly breath, okay? I'll show you the example. Okay, I'm gonna take a deep belly breath, and I need to lose some weight, so don't laugh at me. Okay? So, a deep belly breath. Now I'm gonna inhale and I'm gonna try to pull my belly all the way back to my spine, okay? Now watch my hands. Now when you do that, you can see how much more oxygen you are getting into your stomach. So the more oxygen you get into your stomach, the more that's gonna go to your bloodstream, the more that's gonna help energy, give you energy in your body. So a lot of times, just purposefully, take deep breath, take deep belly breaths. So let's close our eyes right now and let's just do 10 deep belly breaths on your own. Now, when you inhale, just pause for a moment. Then exhale. Okay? The more you exhale, the more carbon dioxide you are putting out, the more waste you are putting out. You're putting out that carbon dioxide where the trees can use. And you're taking in that oxygen where the trees are developing. Okay? All right, so let's just do 10 deep breaths on our own. Try to exhale more than you inhale. At school, I always tell the kids, we're gonna do our 3 deep breath drills. So we're gonna do a couple of breathing activities today, and then we're gonna do a guided practice. Now normally, Kathleen would do a mindfulness practice, and it's not guided. You're guiding yourself. She'll ring the bell, and you will just sit and focus for 10 minutes, okay? But at school, I like to take the kids through a guided practice. When you're doing your guided practice, or when you are doing a practice where you're not being guided, you want to focus on following your breath, okay? Kids say, "Coach, baby, how do I follow my breath?" You know, and I tell them, you simply follow the rise and fall of your chest and stomach. Because let's remember, mindfulness is being in the present moment, okay? Not thinking about the future, not thinking about the past, thinking about right now. And the best thing you can do to think about you and right now is to follow your breath. Now, with any practice, you want to gear yourself and you want to capture your negative thoughts, because you're going to have them. You are going to have them, all right? But that's why we practice mindfulness, because see, negative thoughts leads to stress. Okay? Being overstressed leads to physical illness. That's why my goal, I always say, is to teach these kids at an early age how to deal with stress. And it begins by controlling your negative thoughts. So when you are breathing, you follow your breath. All you're doing is following the rise and fall of your chest and stomach. Sometimes when you're breathing, take deep belly breaths, okay? Just focus on that, okay? Now you're being present. But what's going to happen, and I want you to kind of keep this in mind, and I want you to remember what thoughts came. Because a thought is going to come. And you have to treat thoughts like a cloud. Like, you have to welcome it. Okay, I see that cloud. And then you have to let it go. Okay? But you don't ever want to dwell on any thoughts. Once you start dwelling on the thought, that's when you start having stress. Okay? When you start dwelling on thoughts. Okay? So, the first one we're going to do, I'm going to ring the bell, and we're going to do 3 deep breaths. I'm going to say deep breath in, hold it, now let it out slow. And then we're going to do the second one, okay? Now I'm going to have you to hold it a little bit longer. Then let it out slow. Then the third one, a little bit longer, then let it out slow, okay? And when you let it out slow, you want to think of a balloon with a little pinhole in it. That's how slowly you want to let it out. You want to let it all out. Because like I said, your exhale is more important than your inhale, because you are trying to get rid of that carbon dioxide, that waste, those toxins that are in your body. Okay? All right? So we're going to go 3 deep breaths. Everybody close your eyes. Okay, the first one. Let's take a deep breath in. Real deep and hold it. Real slow. All right, maybe just breathe normal. back to your anchor, which is your breath. Following your breath, in that you might want to focus on deep belly breathing. On the sound of the bell, we're going to take our second breath. Deep breath in, hold it. Follow your breath, follow the rise and fall of your chest and stomach. Uh-oh, there's a thought. Welcome that thought, but let it go. And get back to your anchor, which is the rise and fall of your chest and stomach. Sound of the bell, the last deep breath. Let's make this one real big. We're going to hold it a little extra and let it out slow. Here we go. Deep breath in. Hold it. Just a little bit longer. A little bit longer. Now let it out slow, nice and slow. Follow the rise and fall of your chest and stomach. When the sound of the bell, you want to open your eyes slowly. All right. Okay. Can somebody tell me how that made you feel? That's what you're supposed to feel. You know, this point here. Relax.
Feel the tension, like kind of
ease.
It's kind of calm.
Right. This one kid said, "Coach Baby, you trying to hypnotize me?" I said, "Well, in a way, you're hypnotizing yourself, yeah. You know." So, and you can kind of Google this one, and it's called 478. Okay, you probably heard of that. 478. Okay. Now, what you're gonna do is you're gonna inhale for the count of four. Okay. You're gonna inhale for the count of four. You're gonna hold it for the count of seven. And then you're going to exhale for the count of eight. Why do we exhale more than we inhale? Why do we exhale?
For the carbon dioxide.
Right, to get rid of more of the waste, more of the toxins that are in our body. So you want to exhale more than you inhale, okay? All right? So we're going to do this for three rounds. You're going to do it on your own, 4, 7, 8. You're going to inhale for the count of four. Hold it, count of seven. And exhale for the count of eight. Now remember, what kind of breathing are we doing? Deep what?
Belly.
Deep belly breathing. Okay, we want to try to do our deep belly breathing. Okay, on the sound of the bell, do three rounds. Here we go. you have a nerve called the vagus nerve that kind of runs all the way down your body, and then you have all of these other nerves that are coming out. So when we do these breathing activities, it helps to stimulate that nerve. You have two nervous systems. I mentioned the sympathetic nervous system, which is your fight, flight, and fear, because you know some people, they are always just on the defense, and that's that fight. They're just in a fight mode all the time. Mm-hmm. But then you have the parasympathetic nervous system, which is more so of rest and digest. And this is where you want to be. You want to be more so in that part all the time as much as possible, because now you're not stressed. You're not having a lot of anxieties, okay? You're more relaxed. Another breathing exercises, and you can see how relaxed and how calm you feel. So you can imagine if you can't sleep at night, this would be some good exercises for you to do. Okay, another exercise, and when we're in yoga class, actually, we have a box of tissue, because with this exercise, you are exerting a lot to where you have mucus. Some people, so they just have a lot. But it's called the breath of fire. And
is
what
it,
you want to
is it called
do,
something else? Is it called Kalabana or something?
Kalabata,
yeah.
Yes.
Jim does that.
Yeah,
the
right, that's plan. Right. Yeah, Kalabata, or some people call it the breath of fire. And what you do is you are exhaling and you are letting the inhale be natural. So you're going. Okay? And we're just going to start off by just doing it maybe just about 20 times. I want you. But sometimes people do it through their nose, like. Okay? That's why you have to. I mean, yeah. So I don't want us to get too, you know, but yeah. So when I do it, I just kind of do it through my mouth, like. And on that last one, take a deep breath in. On the last one, hold it and let it out real slow, man. And you can kind of feel how relaxed it is, okay? So, okay, let's do that on the bell. We're going to do it 20 times, and we just going to do it twice. Okay, here we go. At your pace, your pace don't have to be as fast as mine. Gonna go one more time, and some of these activities, just Google them on YouTube, and you know, and you can get more of. They talk about more of the benefits and that type of thing. So let's just do one more section of colored body breath. using your left nostril, that's going to encourage relaxation. If you're using your right nostril, that's going to encourage more activity in your body. So if you feel like you need to be up all night, you want to just do your right nostril. If you feel like you really have to do go to sleep, you want to do your left nostril. So what you do is you can put your fingers on your forehead, okay? And then take your thumb and close your right nostril. Inhale in. Now take your pinky, close your left nostril while you, okay? And exhale through your right nostril. And inhale through your right nostril. Exhale through your left nostril. Okay, relax for a minute. Okay? Relax for a minute. Relax. Relax for a minute. Okay? Now, you see how you're alternating? Okay? You're gonna inhale, close it, then exhale. Then inhale, close it, then exhale. Okay, let's just do about 10 of these, okay? All right, here we go. It's called alternate nostril breathing. Come out of that one. Now, I don't know if you know where it used to be called Sactic Space on Airline Boulevard, right behind Walmart. It's right behind Walmart on Airline Boulevard. And they have yoga classes there. And I got in on the grand opening where there were like, you get two classes for $5. said I was going to try and go, but I have to leave at 9:20 to get to Sunday school. But, but they have yoga classes, and I got in on a couple of them on Mondays, and yoga is great. Yoga is great, and the type of, and you still have the class.
Yeah, with Jimmy Jones at New Creation Monday and Wednesday, free for an hour and a half. Oh, it's wonderful.
What time?
Every Monday and Wednesday, it starts at 10 and it runs to about 11:15. And it's free, and we've been having great turnout. Remember, you came once, and Shirley came once, But he does that. We all do the Kalabata, and then we do the. And he said that alternate breathing. If you do that when you're in the doctor's office, your blood pressure will be lower.
Exactly.
He said, you know how they rush in and they take it, and.
Every time I go into my doctor's office, as soon as I check in, I sit down and I start doing breathing.
It really works. It
calms you down. It makes sense, though.
He does that every session. He's great. Shirley came once. I go faithfully. It's a great class.
So what we're going to do is a mindful sit. It's for about 5 to 8 minutes, and it's going to be a guided practice. Guide you through it, because sometimes Kathleen would just do a practice and you just sort of guiding yourself. A couple of things I want you to remember. You want to follow your breath. Okay, that's your anchor. Follow your breath. I might give you another anchor. I might say, let's focus on the sounds around. Focus on the sounds around us, okay? And, you know, you want to try to concentrate on deep breaths, belly breathing, okay? You've got to remember, and I meant to ask you before, if you have any thoughts that come, try to remember, because I'm going to ask you this time, if you have any thoughts that are coming that you might have to say, okay, let me get back to my anchor, okay? We want to try to focus on that. Then after that, the ladies always do mindful walking. I never do the mindful walking. I think I did it one time.
One time,
yeah,
we went out to the...
What happened?
Yeah, I know.
Doesn't like the
walk. All the more flat, okay, right?
Yeah, and I need to move my back sometimes.
Oh, there, maybe not.
You know, so we just got to do this guided practice. And what I tell the kids, I tell them, okay, you're going to sit up in a mindful position. When you're sitting up like a helium balloon. It's connected to your head, and you're sitting up straight and tall so oxygen can flow through your body, okay? All right, sound of the bell. Let's close our eyes. Listen to the bell for right now, to the quiet. Focus on that bell, that's your anchor for a minute. Let's listen to that bell, to the quiet. Let's focus in on that bell. Bring all your attention to that bell. That's the present moment. Now, as you are sitting, I want you to just see how your feet feel on the ground. You being present. Feeling how your hips, are feeling sitting in the chair. You're being present. Whichever way your hands are, just think about that. You being present. It's just the present moment. Just follow your breath right now as you do deep belly breathing. Take in deep breaths. When you exhale, you want to draw your stomach all the way back to your spinal cord as you exhale. Doing the deep belly breathing, you're exhaling more than you're inhaling. And as you are inhaling, you're inhaling all of the goodness, the happiness, the care, the love, the kindness that you feel about yourself and others as you inhale. Now as you exhale, you're exhaling the negative thoughts, negative thoughts about things that may occur in your life that may cause you worry. As you exhale, you are exhaling these negative thoughts, any type of fear, distrust, anger, resentment. You are exhaling all of these feelings, so you are inhaling the goodness. And you're exhaling that which is not so good. Continue to use deep belly breathing. As you breathe in that goodness, then you fill your lungs up. And you exhale that was just not so good. And you want to do that a little bit longer. Now when you inhale, imagine that oxygen going to your toes. As it's feeding your toes, your ankles, and your legs, that oxygen, which is what you need to stand and walk. Just focus on that oxygen going to your lower limbs, your knees, your thigh muscles, your quadriceps in the front, and your gastrocnemius muscles in the back. Just pause right there as you breathe oxygen to those areas. Let's move up to your internal organs. As you take in that breath of goodness with that deep belly breathing, that oxygen is leaving your lungs. It's purified, going to your heart. And your heart is pushing that blood to your internal organs, your stomach, your pancreas, your liver, your colon. Pushing all of that pure oxygen, purified blood. As you come up through your upper body, through your arms, just imagine that oxygen traveling through those areas and providing that energy that you need to function with those limbs as you continue to breathe. And that oxygen is going up to your brain. As it relaxes that sympathetic nervous system. And it's more focused on your parasympathetic rest and digest. All over your body, oxygen has to be used. energy for the cells of your body. Now just follow your breath for a few seconds, doing deep belly breathing. Focus on the inhale of the goodness of the oxygen, exhaling longer for toxins that are not so good in your body. Any type of thoughts that might be coming, you want to welcome those thoughts. But then you want to get back to your anchor right now, which is the rise and fall of your chest and stomach. We'll give it about 60 more seconds and let's focus on that deep belly breathing. The sound of the bell, you want to open your eyes slowly. I just encourage you that sometime during the day, just get away to yourself, sit outside, a nice calm place. And, if you have any type of ailments, high blood pressure, cholesterol, all of these breathing activities help. I'll tell you another good thing too, and the key is love. I said, okay, we're going to do our laughing session. Sometimes it's good to just laugh.
Mm-hmm.
The kids, they say, well, Coach Baker, what are we going to laugh about? I say, just laugh about laughing. Just, and oh, man, they just get crazy. But sometimes,
laughter's contagious.
yeah, laughing is good therapy. It's good therapy. You're laughing, you're not being stressed about anything. Did anybody have thoughts that came that you welcomed them and they had to go away? I'm going to tell you one thought I had, and this is why I was late. At it takes me 15 minutes, right? 15 minutes. If I leave my house in 15 minutes without anything, I can get you on time. So I put some fish, some catfish, as soon as I get ready to leave them to my wife, put that catfish back in the oven. Well, it's in the oven, she just got to turn it on. But I said, I want to eat me some catfish, because I had gone to Restaurant Depot, and I said, I want to get me some catfish. So I said, if I brought it, it's not going to take me long. So it was 2 o'clock, and man, I put that catfish in there, and I said, I'm going to be late if I... If I cook this catfish, I'm going to be late. So it was 2:06. I said, well, let me go ahead and get in the car. And when I got in the car, it was 2:16. Mm-hmm. I said, I'm going to be late. So as I was meditating right then, I was thinking about that what? What was I thinking about?
That fish.
That catfish. catfish. I was thinking about it, and I said, let me get back to the present. But did anybody have any thoughts where they had to kind of come back? Can you think of anything?
Surprised, I had much fewer than usual, but I did have this vague notion that I need to go to Kroger or Walmart.
Right, and see those things, that it's gonna happen.
It's gonna happen.
I mean, that's just the way that we are created. You're gonna have those thoughts, you know, all day. It's just like my son. I had a quick thought when I got home from Restaurant Depot. My wife said, "You just missed Christian. He's at Virginia State, so he's riding back with some people." So I had that thought. I hope he got there safe, mm-hmm. you know. But then I had to get back to my anchor, mm-hmm. you know. But you gotta have these thoughts, you know, with the kids when they come home, man. I love when they come home, but when they come home, they want to go out. Mm-hmm. So it's so much happening in Portsmouth, and my baby boy, he knows all of those people. They know him. But he has a good crew that he hangs out with. He's at Virginia State. My oldest son, he's at William & Mary. And other than they like day and night, you know. But still, when he goes out, you hear something on the news and you start thinking negative. I hope that's not my son. Mm-hmm. So that's when you have to go into that, you know, yeah. meditation, because you're in that fight, flight, fear mode. And you have to just kind of calm yourself. So.
I think that's good that you recognize that you're going to have those thoughts.
Right.
And instead of dwelling on them, then
right.
you will take that,
mm-hmm.
you know,
right.
that deep breath.
Right. Exactly.
They're like boulders
exactly.
in the path of life, and you got to push them out of the way.
That's right. I like that.
So you,
I like that.
Jim uses that.
Yeah,
and
I like that.
Analogy, you know.
Yeah.
Down the path of life, and just burst those boulders. And,
that's right.
And
I like
you,
that.
Yeah. Yeah,
right.
And then on the inhale, if you're good, even blow them out with your exhale.
Right, yep, that's
yeah.
right, that's
yeah.
right. Anybody else have any comments or?
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm so glad I signed up for this. I was on the Nextdoor app and I saw, first of all, I signed up for this because I work at Subaru and I had the Hoffler Creek Wildlife Preserve as one of our places, and so I participate. I live right here. And I said, I want to try this out.
Okay.
I have people coming to me all day long with negative things.
Mm-hmm.
And I give them everything from tapping to now breathing. You know, and all these different techniques
mm-hmm.
to calm them down and stuff like that.
Right.
And then you said you worked at the school over here.
Right.
And I'm like, I almost didn't come. And I said, no, it's right there. So get your clothes on and walk out. And I am so glad
yeah.
I did. I have a friend, Mary Jane. You may know her. She's a teacher at the academy. Yeah, she was at the academy.
And church?
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Mary James. They started substituting a few other ladies from Canada. But she was telling me, like you had mentioned, we know this area is the worst in Virginia. And a few other friends of mine, Dr. Pelletier, several people were in the educational field, and they got out of it because it was so
yeah.
bad.
Oh, yeah.
Now, the Nextdoor app, I was on it about a week or two ago, and someone posted on there, my child is being bullied at church or in high school. I didn't get their name. I wanted to go up there because I used to work with the DARE program just before COVID
yeah.
at the
okay.
academy.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to do something like what
mm-hmm.
you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
I was just talking about it, you know. And it was like, wow, I am supposed to be here.
Yeah.
I have learned so much from you today, and I want to thank you.
Oh, great.
For having this.
Okay.
And hopefully I can expand on it and participate
mm-hmm.
in a few more things and take it back out into the community.
That's great.
So this has been like...
And then in April she'll do it every Sunday.
Every Sunday,
yeah.
Right.
At the same time, 2:30 to 3:30.
Oh, that's a good time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It'll be warmer maybe.
Mm-hmm.
think I need to go back to.
Oh, you should. We'd love to have it. However, his wife fell, and he won't be there this Monday, and because she's going into rehab to get some strength back. So, but we have, they had recorded one of his classes, because he does the same thing.
Right.
And so we just looked at the big screen, and we all did our thing.
I was going to ask you, how is it presented? Is it stretches and movements?
It's either a chair, or you can bring a mat, or he brings mats for you. So he'll instruct you. If you're on the mat, you do it this way. If you're in the chair, you can stand behind the chair and bend over, and you can do a cap, or you can do a cow, he calls it. And he's just great. You both have been there, Shirley and Coach have come to the class.
So I can't sit in the yoga pose.
He does. He's 80-some years old. He'll stand there with that leg up at the point.
I cannot,
He's amazing. Yeah. He had back surgery. He said the surgeon said
that he helped him out. Sometimes I have a mat and a chair.
Yeah, me too. And then sometimes I use the blocks because he has to bend over. And that hurts. So then he did the styrofoam blocks. And you don't have to go to the floor, but you can just put your hands here. And then he'll say, okay, come up your leg.
Right.
And then he does a lot of this, hands to heart, deep breathing.
Right.
And then
that's
deep breath. And then you exhale, shake your hands. Oh, it's great.
That feels so good.
It has helped me so much between that and coming here. It's like,
this is the first time I've ever done it. With people, I do it from the television. YouTube, stuff like that.
Yeah, it's fun though in person.
Yeah, it is.
And I mean, just brings a different element. It's just like today, because my husband is ill, we had to do church online. So it's not the same, but I have to be here for him. So, it's just more, it's better in person.
Yeah. Right, it is.
Yeah.
Well, ladies, I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed
thank
it.
Thank you.
Last
for
joining last month, it was just Kathleen and I. It was kind of cold. It was real cold, matter of fact. So we stayed in and we talked and we just did another session.
Yeah, that's nice. Yeah.
All right.
Thank you very much, ladies.
Thank you
so much. All right.
Go get your best fish.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, look, I'm glad you told me.
Fish now.
I'm calling my wife right now.
Very